Welcome to RedClean, and this is another initiative of or another way of learning that I'll put daily one question or one clinical vignette pertaining to some rare diseases or sometimes common diseases, and the question will be discussed after 24 hours through a video, and all the options pertaining to that question will also be discussed. Okay, so that, and the question are framed in such a way that the options that you have are basically the DDs, their differential diagnosis, so they're confusing. So the history and all other things, they play an important role in marking the right answer, and it just clears our concept, okay, how to differentiate things. Because when we read things topic wise from the book or somewhere other, then we miss out on differentials. And when the patient comes, we are confused at what exactly the diagnosis is, because the patterns on CT or X-rays, they are so overlapping. So you have to pick objective findings to differentiate. And the initiative basically addresses this issue only. Okay, so in this particular quiz or this question, as you can clearly see, so I'll just first read the question, what exactly it says. And everything will come from the question only, okay? There's a 30-year-old male who had a hematopoietic stem cell transplant 1 year back, presented with complaints of insidious onset dyspnea and chronic cough. The patient is negative for viral markers and his CD4 count is in normal range. His chest X-ray and HRCT image is shown below. What is the likely diagnosis? Okay, there are few important points that I like to mark here that are gonna be important, okay? Yeah, obviously, by the, you know, the history, clearly the patient is a 30-year-old male. Patient is a young patient who had hematopoietic stem cell transplant. Okay, so I can presume that since he had 1 year history of hematopoietic stem cell transplant, I can presume this patient might be on immunosuppressives. Okay, the history suggestive of immunosuppressants. Patient might be, must be on immunosuppressant because he had transplant. Okay, 1 year back, presented with complaints of insidious onset. Now the onset is very important. Since the onset is insidious, onset is not acute. That is another important clue. Okay, it's a insidious onset. This means the history is around somewhere chronic etiology. Okay, it's not acute. That is another clue. Okay, patient had dyspnea, patient started to have chronic cough. Okay, so these are respiratory symptoms primarily. Okay, now patient is negative for viral markers. Okay, now that is another clue. And a CD4 count is in normal range. This means that the question is saying, question wants us to rule out few things. Okay, so by this I can say that viral markers, the common viral markers that we do are HIV, we do hepatitis B serology, and we do Hep C also. But these are the common viral markers we do. Patient is negative for all of them. Okay, patient is negative for all of them. And CD4 count is in normal range. This means that patient's T cell count is normal. Okay, this means that patient is not in immunocompromised state. Okay, this reflects this. Now his chest X-ray and HRCT image is shown below. What is the likely diagnosis? Okay, now as you can see, we presume that, since we presume this patient had transplant and should be on immunosuppressant right now, but the next line, which clearly negated our presumption that patient might be immunosuppressed, okay, that because the CD4 count is a normal range and patient is negative for viral markers, this means that patient could have been HIV positive or patient could have AIDS, in which CD4 count would be low and there will be diseases, you know, opportunistic infections would be the first thing that you would think on this patient. Now look at the chest X-ray and the HRCT image. Okay, so this is the chest X-ray. Okay, and that is the HRCT image. Okay, so this is a chest X-ray. Now what exactly we see? So in this chest X-ray, what we see here is that bilateral lung fields, they show increased density. Okay, so density is increased. Okay, and it's not clear-cut consolidation. Okay, it's not a consolidation because the density, there's a slight increase in density, but it's not dense, it's not completely dense, like it's not obscuring the vessels behind it. So that is, it looks like a GGO. The density looks like a GGO, okay, by this. And you know, the involvement is, you know, primarily diffuse involvement is there, but definitely lower lobes are more involved than upper lobes, that I could say. So there is a little or slight lower lobe predominance, but there is a increase in density, and that's it. That's what we can say. Other structures are quite normal. Okay, now we look at the CT image of this patient. So on the CT image, this is a snapshot. Okay, so X-ray and CT findings are basically correlating, since you can clearly see there is a GGO, diffuse GGO. Okay, in this particular snapshot, whole of the lung is involved bilaterally, and you can see GGOs. But what is the other thing, or the other characteristic thing that you should see, is if you zoom this image, and what is that? This image showing that other than GGOs, what you can clearly see that the lobules are clearly demarcated. You can see this lobule, this lobule, this lobules. These are clearly hexagonal or polygonal structures. They are clearly demarcated. Okay, again, these are demarcated. So you have lobular architecture demarcated. This means that you have what, these linear things. What you have, this is nothing but your interlobular septal thickening. Interlobular septal thickening is what we have, and we have GGOs as well. So this pattern becomes, this is a classical pattern that you see in so many diseases. The pattern is known as crazy paving pattern. Crazy paving pattern. Now this pattern, so on CT we could see HRCT we could see crazy paving pattern. On X-ray we saw findings of GGOs that increased density. Okay, there are few reticular changes, okay, but they're fine. They could not, you could not see simply because, you know, the haziness is quite high. So that is the, you know, imaging findings are suggestive of a crazy paving pattern, okay, involving primarily the lower lobes, but it's near diffuse involvement. Okay, that's what we could see. Now look at the question and try to link the findings with the history. Okay, so 30-year-old male, hematopoietic stem cell, but again we in the next line it clearly says that patient is not immunocompromised because viral markers are negative and CD4 count is a normal range. Now the chest X-ray, HRCT, we saw chest X-ray. So now see, look at the options and try to look at the things. Okay, so the first option is pneumocystis jirofaciae infection. Now if you know this infection, it's a fungal infection. This infection, pneumocystis jirofaciae, is a fungal infection, which is actually an opportunistic pathogen, and it affects our lungs when patient's CD4 count is less than 200. Okay, so it affects our lungs when the CD4 count is less than 200, and classically in AIDS patients you will see these infections to happen. Okay, although it's quite rare here after the initiation of highly active antiretroviral therapy, but if patient's CD4 count goes lower than 200, then you can suspect this infection. And what will the findings, I'll just tell in a minute, but by this history you can clearly rule it out. But it was a closed DD. The only factor in the question that rules it out is the non-immunocompromised state that is there. Otherwise, if you see crazy paving pattern, you can see crazy paving pattern in a pneumocystis infection. Okay, because this infection also classically presents with GGO, and you can have a superimposed interlobular septal thickening that can give rise to a crazy paving pattern. So obviously pneumocystis infection is also a cause of crazy paving pattern. And yeah, history is typically subacute to chronic only in pneumocystis. It's not acute. So the only thing that rules it out as a non-immunocompromised state that we got from a normal CD4 count in this question. Another option, let's look at the third option. Okay, it's pulmonary edema. It's pulmonary edema. Now see, if you look at the about pulmonary edema, definitely it can also cause crazy paving pattern. It can also cause crazy paving pattern because it can cause smooth interlobular septal thickening by edema, smooth due to fluid. accumulation, and GGOs can also be there because there's an interstitial involvement is there. So definitely can cause crazy paving pattern as well. But the important factor that rules it out is that there is no history of any cardiac complaints, or there is no history of or no imaging findings. If you look at the imaging findings again, these findings suggest the normal heart. The heart is normal size. Okay. You can see there is no cardiomegaly, and since you can clearly see the cardiomegaly is not there, okay, there is the cardiac cause is not there. So why would patient have an acute pulmonary edema? Okay, pulmonary edema should not be there because mostly it is cardiogenic. And had it been a non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, it presents like ARDS. Okay, so it presents like an ARDS, non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. Okay, another important point that also rules out pulmonary edema is the onset of the disease in the question. Okay, if you look at the disease onset, it is insidious onset here. But if you look at the pulmonary edema, it's classically acute onset. Okay, so that is why pulmonary edema could not be the answer. And so does the pneumocystis. Now, next DD is, you know, is chronic eosinophil pneumonia. Now, exactly, it is chronic etiology, so it goes with that diagnosis. But chronic eosinophilic pneumonia, if you see the imaging, I have discussed it in eosinophilic lung disease as well. So you can clearly see, let me show you the imaging findings of chronic eosinophilic pneumonia. So these are the imaging findings of chronic eosinophilic pneumonia. If you look at this, now, whenever you encounter an eosinophilic lung disease, if it asks in the question, it will definitely give you two things. They will give you an evidence of peripheral blood eosinophilia always, because eosinophilic lung disease are also always diagnosed, cannot be diagnosed without either a tissue or a peripheral blood diagnosis of eosinophilia. So either you need a tissue biopsy or you need a peripheral blood count where you know eosinophilia is there. So there is nothing like this in history. One thing that goes against chronic eosinophilic pneumonia is this. Another thing in chronic eosinophilic pneumonia is that in chronic eosinophilic pneumonia, the classical picture is of peripheral consolidation or GGOs. Okay, peripheral consolidation or GGOs, which is like this. So see this patch of consolidation, okay, in periphery with a little bout of subpleural sparing, which is not classically visible here. But you see peripheral consolidation or GGOs in chronic eosinophilic pneumonia, and patient also has insidious onset since it's chronic. And patient has classically fleeting opacities that change their position. Okay, so these were the features of chronic eosinophilic pneumonia. Yes, patient can have crazy paving pattern also in chronic eosinophilic pneumonia, because later patient might develop interlobar septal thickening there. Okay, so but imaging findings are not suggestive of CEP, and also there is no presence of eosinophilia. Okay, so this option is also ruled out. Okay, so the only option that is left here is by the exclusion is your PAP, and PAP is your pulmonary alveolar proteinosis. Now that is how a question should be solved, because these DDs are quite close to each other. The only few things that differentiates them is their history, and that's how the patients come also. That you will be having on chest CT, you will be having overlapping imaging findings of several disease, but the only factors that will differentiate between the two or three DDs would be the history, examination findings, and lab findings. Okay, so that is what it is. So pulmonary alveolar proteinosis, let's discuss this topic, what exactly it is, and you'll see that it goes completely, everything goes in favor of this. But you should always come down to it after excluding the common causes. Okay, so look at this now. So when we look at the pulmonary alveolar proteinosis, what exactly it is. Okay, so let's discuss this. Okay, now what exactly it is. By the name, we can see that it is pulmonary. So it's involving lung. Okay, it's alveolar. This means that alveolar are involved in the lung, and proteinosis is that some accumulation of protein is there. Okay, सो अक्यूमुलेशन ऑफ प्रोटीन, प्रोटीन इज अक्यूमुलेटेड इन एल्वोलाई, इन एल्वोलर स्पेसेस, दैट वाज व्हाट एग्जैक्टली इट मींस. नाउ क्वेश्चन कम्स डाउन टू वेयर डज अ प्रोटीन कम एंड व्हाट प्रोटीन इट इज. तो प्रोटीन, व्हाट प्रोटीन गेट्स अक्यूमुलेटेड, द प्रोटीन दैट गेट्स अक्यूमुलेटेड इज सर्फेक्टेंट, सर्फेक्टेंट. ओके, सो देयर इज अ डिपोजिशन ऑफ सर्फेक्टेंट इन एल्वोलर स्पेसेस. नाउ सिंस यू कैन क्लियरली सी दैट, लेट्स से इफ दिस इज एन एल्वोलाई, दिस इज एन एल्वोलाई, वी हैव सर्फेक्टेंट नॉर्मली ऑल्सो इन द वॉल ऑफ एल्वोलाई एंड दिस सर्फेक्टेंट. सो देयर इज अ सर्फेक्टेंट होम्योस्टेसिस लाइक एनीथिंग. नाउ इफ सर्फेक्टेंट इज देयर, डेफिनेटली इफ समथिंग इज देयर, ओके, नाउ इट मस्ट बी कमिंग फ्रॉम समवेयर एंड इट मस्ट बी गोइंग देयर एंड देयर शुड बी बैलेंस बिटवीन द इनपुट एंड आउटपुट. सो दिस बैलेंस इज गॉन इन दिस पर्टिकुलर डिजीज एंड द बैलेंस कुड बी बाई टू थिंग्स. इधर यू सी दैट सर्फेक्टेंट इज प्रोड्यूस मोर और यू सी दैट सर्फेक्टेंट इज वॉट वॉश्ड अवे लेस. ओके, सो लेट्स लुक एट द कॉजेज व्हिच कैन इंक्रीज द सर्फेक्टेंट. ओके, नाउ व्हाट कॉजेज कैन इंक्रीज द सर्फेक्टेंट, सो लेट्स लुक एट दिस. ओके, नाउ फर्स्ट इफ यू सी द कॉजेज ऑफ पल्मोनरी एल्वोलर प्रोटेनोसिस, द कॉजेज कुड बी ईदर द दिस डिजीज कुड बी एक्वायर्ड और दिस डिजीज कुड बी कंजेनाइटल. ओके, इट कुड बी एक्वायर्ड, इट कुड बी कंजेनाइटल. Now, if we got most common cause, if you see, it is most commonly acquired. Okay, only 2% cases are congenital. 2% cases. Okay, so it's quite rare. Now, what exactly congenital causes? So, congenital causes what it causes gene mutations, and these mutations are classically in surfactant proteins. Okay, the genes that code surfactant protein, so surfactant B, surfactant C, these are the name of the proteins. And there's also one more thing that you see that. There's something called GMCSF, that is your granulocyte macrophage colony stimulating factor. Now there's it has a receptor. It's a protein or it's a growth factor that has a receptor. Let's say this is a receptor. Okay, this is a receptor. The receptor is on pneumocytes or type 2 pneumocytes. Okay, receptor in the type 2 pneumocytes. So it binds to this. And this process of binding of GM-CSF will lead to what engulfing of surfactant into these cells, because these cells are responsible for producing the surfactant type 2 pneumocytes. So this binding is important. Now what mutations could do is either they will cause an abnormal surfactant to get produced which doesn't get washed away, or they will lead to receptor abnormality of GM-CSF. Okay, that will cause decreased excretion or decreased coming back of surfactant in type 2 pneumocytes, which will increase the surfactant ultimately. Okay, so that is one thing, congenital. But acquired, what acquired causes can cause? So there are a lot of causes which can lead to PAP development, and that is important because these are the more common causes. And if you look at the question of ours, you can clearly see that the patient was a young adult. Okay, so one thing that can cause it is if the patient is immunosuppressed. Immunosuppression. Now, immunosuppression could be due to malignancy, and it could be due to infection as well. Okay, and what exact malignancies if you talk about? So, malignancy likely to be lymphatic malignancies, lymphomas, leukemias, lymphatic malignancies. Okay, or hematological, if you want a broader term, hematological malignancies. These are the malignancies associated with it. Second thing, it could be due to occupational exposure. And if you ask me what is occupational exposure in which you can have, so answer is silicosis. Now we have silicosis to be divided into acute and chronic. Okay, I'll discuss in detail silicosis and pneumoconiosis a video, but here acute and chronic it is divided. And since acute silicosis is also known as silicoproteinosis because of its appearance like PAP. Now what acute silicosis, when will you suspect acute silicosis? So you should have an occupational history that patient is in a factory or patient is in construction, where patient had or stone mining or rock blasting, something like this kind of occupation. So patient did in rock blasting or in stone blasting, patient can have an acute exposure to a lot of silica, and that patient can develop acute silicoproteinosis with rapid deterioration of respiratory profile. But here also, in our question, the patient didn't have any history of an occupational exposure, patient didn't have any history of an acute onset of these symptoms. Okay, so it goes against it. So patient's malignancy or infection can have, patient immunosuppression can also be due to post-transplant patient. Okay, so now, but and classically patient can also be associated with hematopoietic stem cell transplant, which was a history that we got. Okay, so these are the some conditions. Other, if you are not able to find these conditions, then the fourth cause that you are not able to, when you are not able to know the cause becomes unknown, that is idiopathic PAP is also there. Now this idiopathic PAP is also known as autoimmune PAP. Okay, and if you remember that idiopathic PAP is association with 90% cases of PAP. 90% cases of PAP are actually idiopathic. So you can have cause, or you may be, but most of the most common cause, if you ask, it is acquired, and among acquired, you don't find cause mostly. 90% cases are idiopathic. Okay, in which you have what? You have antibodies, IgG antibodies that are formed against the receptor of against GM-CSF, which results in interference in the degradation or the clearance of intraalveolar surfactant. So in 90% cases, they are idiopathic, and the patients have IgG antibodies against GM-CSF. Okay, so that is it. Now patient here, classically is men or males are affected more commonly, and patient is a young patient, 30 to 50 years of age. Okay, and these are the symptoms we discussed. So in imaging findings, you clearly see that patient's involvement of the lung that primarily occurs here is lower lobes are involved more predominantly, but definitely there is no 100% criteria for lower lobes. The distribution could be anything. You can have upper lobe involvement as well, middle lobe as well, and diffuse involvement also, but definitely if you see the typical case, then definitely I'll call it to be lower lobe predominance is there. Okay, and what exactly patient presents with? Patient will present with ground glass opacities, okay, on x-ray as well as on HRCT, and classically ground glassing is there, or you can see consolidation, but the consolidation is not that dense that it obscures. So it could be, the density is not complete, it should not be complete pitch white. Okay, so there's a density is like this. Then other thing that could be, you can have GGOs, you can have consolidation which is less dense obviously, and then another thing that we have is, so we have GGOs or consolidation, okay, and we have interlobular septal thickening as well. Which I just showed. So in combination, these factors go into crazy paving pattern, which I just shown in the image. And the difference, and the distribution is classically geographic or patchy. So geographic and patchy distribution, okay, of these GGOs and consolidations. So you can have this thing, okay. So that is all about this PAP thing, okay. And these are the findings. So the history is the dominant factor when it, because it differentiates from other causes. One more thing that if you would like to add would be that that is your, that if these PAP patients, are prone to infections, because there is a huge chunk of protein that is there in your alveoli, it is prone, it's a culture media for infective organisms to grow. And if you see, so the superimposed infection in PAP patients classically is of fungi. The fungi that is most commonly involved is your Nocardia. So Nocardia is the most common fungal infection that is affected. Other fungal infections can also be there, like Candida, you can have Cryptococcus, okay, even MAC infections, Mycobacterium avium intracellular complex, or even patient can have, Girovaci infection as well. Okay, so these. So, what exactly the patients, you know, how they are managed? So, you have a large chunk of surfactant produced in your intraalveolar spaces. So, what you do bronchial level lavage for this management. We just take the protein out by lavage, and that is why when the patient has lavage, patient shows remission. Symptoms simply comes down, but definitely as patient has remission, but patient's primary condition is not treated, patient can further relapse with the same findings. Okay, so basically the lifespan is shortened, and if it keeps on occurring, multiple relapses can lead to fibrosis develop. Okay, so this was all about pulmonary alveolar proteinosis. So we discussed it in quite a detail. So that is the purpose of this particular daily quiz, that we discuss one question in detail about its option, how to differentiate it from others, okay, and what are its DDs, so that we have an approach towards a patient, or you should say that patient to diagnosis approach, rather than those videos that we have daily discussion, like in every 2 days or 3 days we have a video in which we describe the disease completely in and out. But definitely this type of learning is also important, because real learning is this only, that when the patient comes and you finally reach the diagnosis from the differentials and you narrow it down by your imaging findings. Okay, so thanks a lot for this, and keep following. If you are not subscribed to this channel, please subscribe this channel. It's going to be of immense use to you and your learning. Another thing that would be that if you want to just see the question and answer the question on you can just join the Telegram group, and I'll just put the link in the description, okay, of the Telegram group. So thanks a lot.